Hello, I am Dr. Kayleen Asbo, cultural historian for the Santa Rosa Symphony. I want to invite you to Weill Hall at the Green Music Center on March 16th, 17th, or 18th. Conductor Emeritus Jeffrey Kahane will take the podium to lead the Santa Rosa Symphony in a beautiful program, American Dreams, that features music of the best American posers that is laced with memories and nostalgia for Paris. We open with the toe-tapping melodies of George Gershwin. George Gershwin had defined the jazz age in New York as he wrote one hit wonder after another with his brother Ira. George, however, always had a hunger to learn more. And so he set out to go to Europe in 1928, where he asked, sometimes even begging, to receive composition lessons from great notable classical composers like Maurice Ravel. Ravel referred him to the famous Nadia Boulanger, who had given an entire generation of American composers like Aaron Copland lessons. The two of them agreed, however, that Gershwin needed no tutelage. He had such a unique voice, and that any lessons would be superfluous for the self-taught musician. Gershwin wedded together a brilliant melodic gift with an infectious sense of rhythm. Though he didn't receive any musical lessons from Ravel or Boulanger, his time in Paris made an indelible impression upon the American. He wrote An American in Paris as a memory book of his own journey. Throughout, he weaves together the sounds of the city. He has memories of playing in blues bars or sitting in a sidewalk cafe with his friends, strolling along the Seine River, and even French taxicabs. One of the most unusual sounds you will hear in this orchestral suite is the sound of French taxicab horns. It complements the brass and the percussion that will be on full display by the Santa Rosa Symphony. Unlike the Leonard Bernstein symphonic dances from West Side Story that we heard earlier in the season, this work began as a purely instrumental memory book, a tone poem, if you will. It was only 14 years after the composer's untimely death that it was turned into the wonderful musical starring Gene Kelly and Leslie Caron. Paris was also the city where Samuel Barber spent time writing his violin concerto, the next work on our program. Barber's violin concerto was partially written in Paris. It was conceived of as a showpiece for a soap magnate's virtuoso son. The work, without any orchestral introduction, opens blossoming with a gorgeous melodic writing. Over a delicate halo of muted strings, the mournful second movement begins with a melancholy melody sung by a lone oboe. It is a technique that Brahms used in his violin concerto, a piece we heard in the fall. and it's one of the ways that composers have conversations across the centuries. This exquisite second movement evokes the same sense of emotion and pathos that the adagio for strings had portrayed just a few years earlier. According to some stories, however, the intended violinist was not impressed. He felt that the music was not flashy or showy enough. According to legend, Barber responded by writing this virtuosic third movement, a perpetual motion feast of sound in which the breathless violin scampers to the very end. People are never satisfied. According to the oft-repeated legend, the violinist balked at this third movement, saying it was unplayable, impossible, much like the Tchaikovsky and Beethoven concertos had been considered earlier. Eventually, Barber found a violinist to bring it to life. On our stage, the virtuoso Elena Urioste will be bringing this work to life. And we will hold our breaths as the Santa Rosa Symphony and Elena scamper to the breathless finale. Paris was also the home for a while for Aaron Copland, considered by many to be the father, the prophet, or the priest of American music. He had gone to the Fontainebleau School to study with Nadia Boulanger, and it was under her encouragement and tutelage that he developed his stylistic sound, one that is filled with spacious harmonies, with fifths and fourths evoking the wide open places of America's heartland. Copland went on to write the ballets that defined much of American cultural life in the 20th century. Appalachian Spring, Rodeo, Billy the Kid. He sketched in his musical portraits the visage of Abraham Lincoln. And he scored for film Steinbeck's Of Mice and Men. During World War II, Copland, like many composers, was commissioned to write a fanfare to boister the military during its time of strife and travail. The ensuing work, The Fanfare for Common Man, was Copland's way of saying that it wasn't one particular battle or victory that should be celebrated. Rather, it was the courage that ordinary people showed every day. At the end of World War II, the Fanfare for Common Man became the foundation for his epic and monumental Symphony No. 3. It was seen as a way to bring together the world after a time of darkness, to celebrate the heroism of our country, and to renew ourselves in optimism after a time of disaster and despair. The first movement of Symphony No. 3, Molto Moderato, unfolds with aching grace. It builds with a sense of unease into an arch shape before returning tenderly to its opening melodic material. Movement Allegro is like a scherzo, filled with vibrant energy in the percussion and brass. The third movement is deeply emotional. From its quiet and spare beginning, Copland leads us through a landscape that shifts between shadow and darkness and consolation. It evolves seamlessly into a quiet, tender, transparent, almost quivering evocation of the fanfare for the common man before bursting forth in a blaze of glory. Copland's Third Symphony has been considered to be a foundation of American music, a call to courage, an evocation of hope. The poet Rainer Maria Rilke once said that the future must enter us as an image long before it can happen. Copland, in this symphony, planted seeds that we might well remember in this time in our life. Seeds of a call to hope and to optimism after struggle. Can we dare to imagine, like Aaron Copland did in his Third Symphony, a wide open, spacious place of harmony and optimism filled with new possibilities? We at the Santa Rosa Symphony hope that our program of American music that we will offer in March will not only remind us of the glories of America's artistic past, but inspire us all to a better and more beautiful future. An hour before each of our concerts, you are invited to join conductor emeritus Jeffrey Kahane and our illustrious violin soloist as they engage in a conversation about this magnificent program. If you'd like to go deeper into the history of music, I invite you to join me here at the Petaluma Historical Library and Museum for Musical Mondays, where we will celebrate the musical dreams across the centuries.